I suppose, Richard, when you talk about empathy, we're talking about standing in the shoes of others, trying to better understand. Honesty about the context of the past. I used a term a few months ago, which I got a bit of stick over. I said it was time to stop lying about the truth. And what I meant by that was we need to be a bit more honest and a bit more realistic about what we can deliver out of the past. We're going to ask George and Anne to rejoin us now. And we're also going to bring our political guests into our conversation. Claire, Chris and Alastair have been name-checked already as the evening has developed. I remember at the time of the last election, an academic, Pete Sherlow, describing nothing has changed, but everything has changed. And I think we see the generational shift in our politics in terms of those who have joined us tonight. I think that's a good thing. And I think we, as people who lived through the conflict period, need to stop shoveling our experiences on top of the generations that are coming behind us. So the next big steps, the next 15 years, Claire and Alastair and Chris are all going to be a big part of that. And it would be nice to hear from them now on what they've heard tonight, their thinking on what they've heard tonight, where they think we are in terms of the policing journey, the devolution of policing and justice powers. Is policing ahead of the community in terms of progress that has been made? So Claire's going to say a few words first, the Justice Minister, Claire Sugden, and then we'll hear a few words from Alastair and Chris, and then we'll begin our conversation with the studio. So a big welcome for our Justice Minister, Claire Sugden. Claire, can you just check that sure. Mic...
one of them there, yeah.
Whatever the closest one is to you, yeah. Yeah.
Good evening, everyone. I suppose just my reflections on what's already been said so far. I'm an elected representative, which means I represent the people of my constituency first and foremost, East London, Derry. Now, as Justice Minister of Northern Ireland, I would like to think that I'm representative of the views of people right across Northern Ireland. And I suppose, in terms of what Professor English said around empathy, I have 2 degrees in politics, and you don't need a degree to be a politician. But I would say the most valuable thing that I took from my 2 degrees in politics was the skill of empathy, because I do think that's really important. I think it would be naive of me to say that I don't have a prejudice. We all have prejudices, and that's fine. And that's why I think empathy is entirely important. We don't have to agree with the actions that people took, but I think we can go some way in moving forward if we can understand where they came from. I'm certainly of the mind that everyone's on a journey, and the actions that brought them to the decisions in their lives are a product of their upbringing, their circumstances, their context, as was alluded to earlier. And certainly in my approach as Minister, I believe that in order to move forward in Northern Ireland, we have to strip it back, we have to understand so that we can move forward. And indeed, policing is part of that puzzle, I believe. It's interesting because 15 years ago, I was 15 years old. I don't remember too much about it. I remember the peace process. I remember the journey in terms of what we heard on the news, those types of things. I remember the contention around the change from the RUC to the PSNI. But I'm at a stage now, 15 years later, Justice Minister of Northern Ireland, where I almost describe that period, these past 15 years, as a period of transition. And I think now, in a new mandate, with an executive, which, you know, I'm sure my colleagues would agree with me in saying that we are quite united in terms of wanting to move forward, this mandate's about delivery, transformation. So I think it is about transition, and now we're in a stage of transformation. I think even my journey on becoming Justice Minister in itself is a step forward. I designate as a unionist in the Northern Ireland Assembly, And it's a huge leap forward that political parties were happy to vote me in from both communities as their Justice Minister of Northern Ireland. And certainly I think the next step is that we eventually bring justice into the normal to haunt arrangements. And whether that will happen after these 5 years or whether that will happen within 10 years, it's something that we need to move towards. When I look at policing in Northern Ireland today, I try to understand what is the role of our police force. I agree with comments made earlier that the police is almost the last point. It's almost when other public services have failed, that's when the police service come into play. Is that appropriate? No, it's not. And what does that mean? It means that this is not just the role of the PSNI, it's not just the role of the Department of Justice, it's the entire executive. And also, I was pleased to hear that it's the role of the public of Northern Ireland. Civic responsibility is something that I advocate for. I think the community and voluntary sector in particular, they are best placed to serve the people that they know best. Should it be up to the police? Not entirely, no. Should it be up to our communities? Yes, I think it is. So I think in terms of moving forward, we need to understand the role of the police in 2016. We need to bring our communities, take some responsibility for how we can move forward on that. And I think we're in the space to do that. We are in a context now in 2016 where people want to move forward. The issues that I talk about as Justice Minister are not necessarily the legacy issues. They're domestic violence, they're fear of crime within our older community, children and young people within the justice system, rural crime. These are issues that matter to people on a day-to-day. And I won't leave behind the legacy issues either. I think it's really important that we address them. I think a lot of people assume that our generation would just like to draw a line and move on. But I don't think we can, because we can't draw a line. And it is timely in terms of legacy. Legacy essentially for me is about victims and addressing and acknowledging what they feel they need from this process. If we don't do it for the people who are with us, it will pass to the next generation, and I've already seen that happen. So I think in order to truly move on, we do have to address, like I said, it's something that I'm keen to do. But in parallel, we also have to address the needs of the people of Northern Ireland, and they are on those day to day. So I probably in my speech didn't talk too much about policing. That's a good thing, because in order for policing to move forward, it has to be a wider societal approach that we take. And we can only do that in a joined up executive and approaching this in a very cross-cutting way. I don't even like to call it cross-cutting, I like to call it interdepartmental working, because that's important. And you know, we're at the beginning of the journey in that respect as well. Our new programme for government approach certainly encourages that type, but again, even that in itself will be a journey and something we will learn from. But collaboration, going out and speaking to the people that matters, I think that's how we learn, how we move forward. So I think that the first two speeches were something that very much resonated with me, and I know my approach is along a very similar vein and how I will take the next 5 years.
Thank you very much, Claire. And I think the point you made there goes back to the point that Tim Mayers made earlier in the week, that policing works best when the police actually only play a small part in it. I've been told that you need to use your mics that are on the table. So, Alastair, if you would... take that, and Chris as well. And I don't know which of you wants to go first. Have you any particular preference? Alistair's going to go. So Alistair Ross, and then we'll hear from Chris Hazzard, and then we'll begin our conversation with the panel. Thank you very much, Claire.
Chris just wants to see what I say so he can respond to it. You know. I was trying to think what I was doing 15 years ago as well. I was at university in Dundee, and I suppose it was around about the time when I got interested in politics as well, because I didn't come from a political family. We weren't members of political parties. We weren't having discussions about politics around the dinner table. But around that time of the Belfast Agreement and the changes in policing and all of those changes that were happening in Northern Ireland got me interested in politics and taking more of an interest in the change that was happening. And as somebody who had a grandfather who served in the RUC, I think that the context of change is important. And when I listened to Richard talk about context being important, we have to remember that those of the political parties who were opposing change at that time did so in a very different context. And they did so when the terrorist threat was still very much alive, when all political parties weren't supporting constituents going to the police or the rule of law, and we had a really difficult political situation at that point in time. So it's not wrong that there was hostility towards change, that people felt a degree of anger, a degree of hurt around those who had given so much to protect wider society. And of course, when we talk about 80% approval levels for policing today, it was very different back in the early 2000s when a huge section of the community were opposed to police, were very skeptical or suspicious of them. So I suppose in that sense, there has been tremendous change in this short period of 15 years, and an unimaginable change, I suppose, as well, if you consider what might have been possible at the beginning of 2000 or 2001. The challenge and context is changing as well, and other speakers have already mentioned this. Crime itself is changing. Violent crime is still there, it's still a risk to us, but increasingly we see crime move into the online world, and cybercrime is something that is affecting so many people across society today, and how we police that is particularly challenging. How we warn people and protect people, and that sort of preventative policing plays a more significant role than perhaps it ever has before. I think the expectation on the police is changing as well, and perhaps the idea of having a very visible police force and having a police station in every town is one that is no longer sustainable. I mean, people report crime in very different ways now. People engage in social media, if I'm allowed to mention that, and report crime through social media, and a police force needs to be responsive to that. And I think increasingly people are able to report crime or learn about issues in their community through social media, and the police need to be aware of that. It was mentioned around some of the other challenges, so many challenges that the police face are around alcohol or mental health issues. I think that's hugely important as well. So the police force aren't just there as a force, they're there as a service, and a service to not only try to take dangerous people off the streets, but also protect vulnerable people as well. And I have many friends here in the police force, and some of the things that they do and they see is hugely difficult and has a lasting impact on them. In terms of how we respond to them at some of these things, Claire's mentioned the programme for government. And I think increasingly we are of a view that we need to try to help change some of those difficulties. We need to have a problem-solving approach. So perhaps rather than always looking towards the police or the criminal justice system to solve some of the big issues that we face, perhaps we need to look at the education system, the health system. So if you have a drug addiction, perhaps getting the police to go out and arrest somebody and put them behind prison isn't going to solve the issue. In fact, it just puts them in the revolving door of the criminal justice system. We need to have the right interventions. We need to give support to people and give them the opportunity to change their lives. And I think the police service has a huge role in doing that and helping the wider context. In terms of the role of the policing board, it was mentioned as well. I think that, again, the role of the policing board has changed dramatically over 15 years. Initially set up to make sure that there was nationalist buy-in towards policing and eventually Republican buy-in as well. I think we're beyond that now, and we need to get beyond the policing board as just simply being about getting buy-in and representation across the community. It has to be something very different to that, and I would hope that in the age of the devolution of policing and justice in the last 6 years as well, that there's more collaboration between the policing board and the Justice Committee or the Assembly as a whole, because I think that that's hugely important, because none of these issues sit in isolation, and we need to make sure that they all work collaboratively together. And again, that's something which is included in the programme for government. So I think that when you zoom out and you look at progress over the last 15 years, everybody would say we've made huge progress, not just in policing, but across the board in Northern Ireland, and we live in a much better place than we ever did before. We do have to deal with some of the legacy issues from the past. The government are in a position where they're hoping to, what they have described as going into the more public phase of consultation on the structures. But we need to make sure we get them right. And I've heard a number of people already say we just need to get it done. Something needs to be done, or we need to just get on with it. We need to make sure we get it right, because if we set up structures that don't work and we don't meet public expectation, or one side of the community feels that the architecture isn't delivering for them, then I think that creates real difficulties for us. So I think it's right that we take the time to get it right, and that we make sure that we get maximum buy-in to whatever those structures look like, that we give people hope that if they want to get a justice solution, if they want to bring people to justice, that there's an expectation or a real possibility that could happen. For those who just simply want to find out the truth, we have to make sure that the structures are set up that they have the ability to get to the truth. And we have to make sure that everything that comes out of the legacy structures that are set up provides the context and reports and facts and doesn't isolate any single part of the community. So look, it's a huge challenge, but it's one that I don't think that the executive is going to duck.
Thank you, Alastair. And I think one of the points that Alastair's making about we need to continually remind ourselves about the progress we have made. I'm sure many people in this room will speak to those who visit us on a regular basis from international conflicts, who would give everything they have for what we've got. So while we've a journey to make and we've further steps to take, I don't think for one minute we should take for granted what we've got. 20 years ago, and Richard mentioned a little bit of this, even 10 years ago, would we have thought that we were going to get to where we are today? So Chris Hazzard is going to say a few words. Chris, Sinn Féin member of the executive, and then we'll have 40 minutes or so with our audience in a Q&A. So Chris.
No problem, Barney, thanks. And I suppose just at the outset, just to pass on the Deputy First Minister's apologies for not being able to make it. He is in Dublin tonight at the All-Ireland Brexit talks. Look, I'm delighted to be here to fill in, and you know, certainly, you know, my experience, you know, and we've talked about where we've come from, and Martin's would have been very different, of course. You know, neither of us are Arsenal supporters, unfortunately, but you know, don't hold that against us. But no, whenever I was becoming first involved with Sinn Féin, I suppose at a very local level, policing was the big debate. You know, it was very clear that this was a huge issue for the, you know, the nationalist and republican community. You know, I remember going to town hall meetings, you know, maybe five times the size of this meeting here this evening. You know, the tension in the air. You could feel that this was an issue at the very heart of where the political process was going to go. You know, the involvement of political leaders right down into the community. You know, to sense the feeling on the ground, but also to lead on the way forward. So I have no doubt that, you know, people that were sitting in them rooms, you know, back in the early noughties, whatever you want to call it, you know, to where we're sitting here today, as other members have pointed out, it has been a remarkable journey. Now, of course, the challenge for us all is younger people nowadays, to a certain extent, don't really care about that. And they do take for granted that the change has been made. And it's not just in policing, it's across reconciliation, society, whatever it might be. You nearly have a situation where you say, so what, that was then. We are where we are now, and what does the future hold for us? And we need to bear that in mind. So I think tonight, and I think this you know, discussion around the, you know, the 15-year anniversary is important, because it's as important as it is looking back. You know, we do need to concentrate on some of the challenges, therefore, that are coming down the line, and I think they've been aptly talked upon here this evening. You know, Brexit, you know, when we look at the importance of human rights have been in that context to date, you know, what is that going to spell out for the future? Even a hard border, you know, the challenges operationally and politically that may face upon policing going forward, you know, what is that going to have? Resourcing. And you know the huge challenges we know of public finances across government, and you know, I certainly want George to have more money, so enforcement of cycle lanes and parking as an infrastructure minister, you know, but that's what it's about, because frontline resourcing is hugely important, but equally important is that we have resourcing adequately for the police ombudsman office and the other bodies that are so important as well, because that's where we've come to. And I suppose for me too that while plenty has been done about representativeness, and it's so important here, and, you know, when we have to acknowledge where we have come from. I was pleased to hear the Chief Constable's remarks tonight, because we're simply not at the position where we can settle for what we've got, and that's not just, you know, community background with regards to faith or, you know, even gender, but ethnic minorities as well. We increasingly welcome people from all around the world, to this part of the world, to make their home. And it's time that, you know, those from, you know, ethnic minorities certainly play a bigger part. And that's not just a challenge for police, of course. That's a challenge right across public life. you know, you look around the Assembly chamber and there are, now that Anna Lowe is gone, there are no longer any ethnic minorities represented in the chamber. You know, and no offence to anybody sitting on the panel of the audience, it tends to be middle-aged white men with bald heads who dominate the civil service, who dominate public life. And you know, we need to do more to do it. But you know, I was pleased to hear George say that, you know, he as Chief Constable, obviously as the employer in the police service, has a responsibility there too. And I think, you know, when we're here to challenge and to cajole and to consider each other, we should consider the point, if we compare the police service with the judiciary, why is it that, you know, Catholics make up so much more the judiciary now, and certainly the Catholic and nationalist Republican community maybe have bought into that to an extent, where there maybe is more issues with the police service. Why is that the case? And, you know, maybe there's something there we have to look at. And I suppose, finally, you know, touching upon legacy, as has been alluded to by others, you know, in 1998, I was 13 at the time the Good Friday Agreement was signed. My only real memory of the conflict would be the Lockett Island massacre. I remember that night vividly. And again, because I come from that community, that has very much been with me the entire time. And I suppose that brings me into legacy. And I think we stand at a crossroads here. And when it comes to confidence, and I recently met with the British Secretary of State and we discussed this, you know, I think certainly in the office of the Secretary of State, there has been serious damage done with confidence to the nationalist Republican community over recent years. It needs to be addressed. And I put that to James Broken Charlotte, it needs to be addressed. Certainly, I think we need to see that now. We need to be mindful of that. We're in that arena now when it comes to dealing with legacy. You know, so I hope we can deal with legacy. You know, Richard has said that, you know, everybody may not be happy with what happens, but we need to move forward now. I think those around the table, you know, have to act in the interests of the citizens. You know, and no doubt we may touch upon it later, but I think we stand at a crossroads there because the confidence and maybe the effect of confidence that flows from that can be very, very damaging. You know, social media also, we touched on, it just came to me as well. I was recently involved in a discussion, and this isn't an issue in my particular part of the world, but the practice of stop and search in Belfast and Derry, and the fact that that can explode on social media. We know certain practices outside schools, for example, and this can explode on social media. And as we've seen in America and other places at the minute, once something like that happens on social media, it's very often you know, hard to counteract. But you know, I know certainly this has been a practice that hasn't been the same since George has come in, so again, praise where praise is due to that extent. But certainly that would be some of the challenges that I see going forward, and perhaps some of the issues that our young people might say, yeah, these are now what we need to deal with. And, you know, it's great that we've progressed to the extent that we have, but we now need to stand up and make sure we take the right steps going forward.
Thank you very much, Chris, and thank you, Claire, and Alastair also. So it's over to the audience. There will be a handheld mic, or maybe more than one handheld mic out there. If someone doesn't ask the first question, I will pick someone from the audience to ask it. So I wonder if anyone would like to get us started. One of those interviewed in that film with Tim Mears the other night was Dr. Johnny Byrne. Is he hiding there at all? Yeah, he's here. And one of the points he made was that it's okay for the police on occasions to say no. The police don't have to say yes to everything. And maybe that might be a thought from the floor that gets our conversation started. So could someone maybe bring a mic to Johnny Byrne here, just trying to hide his head under his chair.
I was nearly on top of the police ombudsman getting away from me there, Barney. No, I suppose that my point was, and it feeds into it, I remember, George, a colleague of yours started this conversation about a year ago about when is it okay to say no in terms of policing, and I know that's a very simplistic way of looking at it, but I suppose the question would be for the panel, do you think that one of the negatives of the pattern or of the last 15 years is that there's been an over-expectation about what policing can deliver because there was an emphasis on such an emphasis on going beyond what normal policing was seen in other Western states in terms of engagement, in terms of delivery, in terms operational call-outs, and in the last 15 years, because there was such a vacuum and a gap around policing, that an environment was built where there was such a focus placed on policing that now, when we're 15 years into a process, that we're living with the legacy of that overemphasis on policing. And the question was, the focus is on the PSNI and the Board on Accountability 15 years on, but should the focus be on the wider public services around policing and community safety and where that looks 15 years into a peace process?
George, you'll probably need a mic off the table there.
Okay. Yeah, framing the assertion and policing needs to learn say no is probably a pretty negative way of putting it, but I get the point behind Johnny's comment. For policing to say no or to step back from some issues and not to be dominating the response all of the time will actually require others to step forward. And we heard one of these two esteemed academics, I can't remember which, although I was listening, but we talked about a more preventative approach and the effectiveness of early intervention, more collaboration. And you have that sort of academic assertion along with that working really well in other jurisdictions. And actually, even when we do a little bit of it here, it tends to work well. It's far better problem solving. It's other people engaged, other people taking responsibility, rather than it being left to the last resort of the police. To do that, we get hung up in our devolved space here around budgets and money and finance. I'm not signing a check away to anybody tonight, but actually real collaborative working starts with information sharing rather than resource sharing. And I'm heartened by the programme for government, the outcomes-based accountability, the outcomes-based approach, because if we're going to do that, it's going to need to be interdepartmental, as Claire has said, or cross-cutting, call it whatever you want, but actually, the departments setting the budgets, the policy, the legislative framework, all of which is very important. But you know what? You see, in terms of operational delivery, it should be a little bit far removed. It's actually the delivery agents, whether it's social services, education, housing, policing, prisons, whoever, that need to get joined up at the service delivery end. And we all will preciously guard our ever-reducing budgets. That's sort of human nature and understandable. The bit that we should be more generous about is finding a mechanism within the law to share information, to allow for greater collaboration, to allow for more intelligent, earlier intervention. So rather than framing it as the cops need to learn to say no, we actually need to learn to work together and to say yes to information sharing is probably my starting point on it.
Okay, thank you, George. Do we have a question from the floor? Just here at the front. Is that you, Barney? Yeah.
Thank you. I'm Dave Anderson. I'm the MP for Bladen and the Shadow Secretary of State for Northern Ireland. Can I just start by saying to George and to Richard about empathy? Arsenal didn't show much empathy at the stadium light on Saturday, that's for sure. I also want to pick up one about appreciation and, you know, give my real firm appreciation on behalf of myself and of my party for the great work what you've all done in transforming this part of the world. And it isn't just about what you've done here, because if you hadn't done what you've done here, we'd have still been sending young lads and lasses from my part of the world to come over here and to, you know, fight and sadly die in your streets. So it's really, really heartfelt for me about how far you've come in what is really a relatively short space of time. I want to pick up on one of the things about the pressures on the police service. I met a couple of weeks ago with the police Fed, and they were saying to me about the real concerns they have about the increase in the number of days that are being lost for psychological injuries, which have gone up from 24,000 4 years ago to 37,000 now. Now, you know, I'll share with all of you the fact that there's bound to be an impact of budget cuts in that. But I just want to ask whether there's, you know, a collective strategy to address this going forward, and particularly the point that Richard raised, because I thought, Aogán raised, I think, about is there a way in which we can get the community to share the load? Because if we can, then obviously that's something, if it can work here, would be great for us and the rest of the UK. So first and foremost, thanks very much for what you've done.
David, thank you. Anne, would you and George and Claire maybe think of saying something to that question, particularly about a strategy around those who have been psychologically injured and what has been done, what more needs to be done? You'll need to share a mic there. Well, okay. Maybe Claire, do you want to say? Yeah.
Sure. I suppose there's been a lot of conversation recently about mental health issues within Northern Ireland, and I actually think it's almost a hidden legacy of the troubles of our past. You know, we now in 2016, a lot of people who would have had experience of the troubles, whether directly or indirectly, will now be coming to retirement age through we're an aging population. And I think what might manifest is the outworkings of that trauma that people face during the Troubles. Whether it's the police service, whether it's the prison service, whether it's any of the frontline services, and I'm talking about the ambulance service, the fire services, people who were directly involved with that, I would have a concern that it is manifesting into a mental health problem. And again, it will be something that within justice I'm keen to look at, particularly within my remit area, so whether it's the police force or the prison service. But again, it goes much wider than that. We have to look at it right across the Northern Ireland Executive, particularly around health and what they're doing to approach that. I think we have to have the conversations about how the Troubles did affect people. I'm very much learning, even within my own remit, that people coming within the criminal justice system have had some sort of trauma in their life, and it has manifested into them perhaps committing an offence, which has then led them to go to into custody. And then almost it's a downward spiral from that point. So I think there's a legacy around mental health issues with the Troubles, but I think more generally as well. And I think one of the themes that seems to be emerging from this conference this evening is we need to tackle our issues upstream before they get downstream. The police service, the Department of Justice, we should not be that last point when we failed in other areas, which is why I think generally there needs the programme for government itself is that strategy, because I think it's the cross-departmental working to have an honest conversation about the issues that are affecting our society, and that doesn't fall to one minister or one department, it falls to the entire government. And as I said earlier, I don't think it will be easy, but it will be a wider conversation rather than what one particular agency or department is doing about it. So.
Well, I suppose a good starting point, Claire, is that we're actually having the conversation now, David. You know that so many of us bottled the conflict period up. We're afraid to talk in our sleep and are only really beginning to have these conversations in recent times. And I think that's another something that we shouldn't take for granted. We can bring people into rooms now, and Richard mentioned it earlier in his comments. People who wouldn't have sat comfortably in rooms with each other not that many years ago. And I actually hear on occasions, David, in rooms, in those informal conversations, more truth and honesty than we might get in a legacy process. So, and that's the point I was trying to make earlier about what it is we're trying to do in addressing the past, working out what it is we're trying to do, and then working out the best way of doing it. George, do you want to say anything, or Anne, do you want to say anything in response to that question, or do you think we can move on? Or
well, probably just to acknowledge the issue that the past has on mental health internally for us. We take that seriously. We have, by comparison with any other police service in the UK, a state-of-the-art occupational health and well-being unit. It's never enough, frankly. It has suffered the squeeze of financial pressures like every other part of public service. So much so, actually, that the Police Federation stepped up to the mark. It's almost to our shame, really, in terms of how we use public money. But they made £1 million contribution to bolster occupational health provision, specifically around mental health issues. And what we're doing is using that contribution from the Police Federation, plugging it into the current existing structures. But so as a staff association, as well as them asking prickly questions of me and holding my toes to the fire, or whatever the right metaphor is, they're actually putting their money where their concern is as well. Mm. So both from a staff association point of view and from a senior leadership perspective within the service, we take this seriously. We've brought in Jude Hilliker as the new director of HR from outside, who is leading on a whole strategy around employee engagement and well-being. We've engaged the University of Durham on a highly professionalised, evidence-based survey to understand what the feeling of the organisation is, to drill into what the issues are that will help us address well-being. So we're taking it seriously. The organisation is only as good as its people, so we need to look after our people. And I think it's a valid challenge from the Shadow Secretary of State. Do you want to say anything?
Yeah, we'll have a few words from Anne, and then we'll take our next question. Yeah.
Just to say that I don't think it's something that we've really taken very seriously over the last few years. It's really now a focus. The board has been focused on so many things, and the focus was mainly on police officers who were physically injured. And I don't think any of us really understood the huge suffering that was going on with people mentally. That has become more and more, I think, in the minds of board members now. We have a very good relationship with our police federation, and we do meet with them. We get regular reports from the PSNI, and we really have begun to really see the need to look at the duty of care to our officers. But we're quite shocked at the level of it. And I don't think the public have any awareness of it either. You know, you do it and you get on with it. But actually, when you hear the stories of what some people have to deal with on a day and daily basis. I've been to some of the internal awards ceremonies, and I would say about 50 out of the 55 people are officers who've all at some stage gone into a river to rescue someone or have witnessed something horrendous. And we take that for granted, and we shouldn't. So I personally would like to see a strategy, and I think it wouldn't just be for PSNI officers, but also fire service and ambulance crews who also are traumatised by some of what they have to deal with. And in that respect, I welcome the opportunity to work with those services and working with our colleagues in the Assembly to get a strategy that we can actually do more for these people.
Thank you, Anne. I see Trevor Ringland raising his hand here, just a couple of seats from the back.
Yep. Trevor Ringland, and I think it's great to see some young politicians there, some new faces, and certainly my generation. Some of the things that we've put up with in the past is in order to free up for the future for you younger politicians to shape the future in a different way to that past. And so making a comment, it's really for the younger politicians to reflect upon, but it's maybe for the academics maybe to comment on. And taking Richard's structure, the appreciation, first of all, is 15 years on, Northern Ireland is so much better a place now than it was 15 years ago, 30 years ago. And it really is improving all the time, and a lot of our society are moving on. It's an appreciation also that an awful lot of people have bitten their lips and stayed quiet in many different ways in order to allow our society to move on and create the future or the present that we now enjoy. And it's also an appreciation that we have a real opportunity to make sure that violence never, ever again is used on this island to further any political cause. The context is that in order to get here is that politically, we had to take a decision to include all of those in that political settlement. And that included some of those who perpetrated some tremendous and terrible crimes, whatever side you look at. But working in that context of the political settlement that we arrived at, it always compromised how we would deal with that past. And in that way, it may be that realistically, we're left with no other opportunity than, or no other alternative, but to actually suspend dealing with the past, whether it be injustice issues or real truth investigation. But if this is the reality, then we need to be honest with the victims. And so the empathy is that we have to recognise to those victims that we need to be honest and truthful with them about what we can deliver for them.
So is that your question, Trevor?
It's for the academics to comment on. And just let me finish very shortly. And it is that if we are going to do that, then we have to at least listen to the hurt that has been caused to them, understand the impact right across our society that violence has had, and that might help shape the future in a way that we ensure that violence never happens again.
So, okay, Trevor, thank you. So the possibility of suspending justice and truth, and also that part of your question about being honest, with victims in terms of what can be achieved. So we'll maybe go to our three politicians first, and then we'll come to Richard and Aogán. Is that okay? You want to? Okay. All right. Okay.
Okay, well, thank you, Trevor. I mean, two points on that. One is that I think that if there is a profound lesson from what's happened in the last 50 years in Northern Ireland, it's that we're unlikely to resolve that which we want to resolve through violence. And I think the certainty of human damage, the certainty of polarization, the certainty of division are strong with political violence. The chances of resolving the political problems we have are virtually nil through violence. And I think most people in the North, most people in Northern Ireland and the Republic, most people across these islands accept that. And I think that means that in the future there will be a very different context. And I think in time there will be a different kind of politics with new generations of people. We see some of this tonight with our distinguished guests. With people who are not troubles politicians, if you know what I mean. They're people who've come through a different generation. And I think the transformation of relationships between political parties, between political communities at that stage will be the reward for the investment that this generation has made in the peace process. On the past and victims, absolutely right. I mean, it should be the voices of the victims which are the loudest in any room like this. I think also honesty is important. There is not going to be public and full truth about who did what in the Troubles. It's not going to happen. What you can do is try to deal with those doors you can open meaningfully, which provide redress. And what you can do is to try to find as honest a process as is humanly feasible in a flawed context. There isn't a reconciliation process on the planet that has produced absolutely full truth, and we're certainly not going to get it here. But that doesn't mean we can't do anything. And I think what we can do is try and move forward those processes of understanding and explanation which are available. And I think it's a depressing thing, Trevor, but in 50 years' time, the generation that's there, if we do carry on with the journey we're on at the moment, which is broadly a peaceful journey, we'll be able to be involved in different kinds of relationships, not only with each other, but possibly with unearthing truths about the past that it would be too painful and destabilizing for us to do at the present.
Okay, thank you, Richard. And we'll hear from Aogán, yeah?
Yeah, it's such an important issue, and if you've been affected personally, you know, there's pain that nobody else will feel. They might feel empathy, a term we've talked about, but they won't suffer the pain that you have suffered. And if you look at the surveys of experiences of violence and the Troubles, a surprisingly large number of people have been affected by it directly. So 3,800 people dead, so many thousands injured, but practically everybody has a close link somehow. In terms of dealing with it and parking it, the fact of the matter is that a considerable amount of effort is already being expended on not dealing with it. And as a consequence, I think it's being dealt with in a very haphazard, in a very uneven way. And this, in a sense, raises one of the worst fears that somebody might have, the fear of being forgotten, the fear of being lost in the stampede. Everybody else will get truth and I'll be left behind. So you see a flurry of hands being raised, me, please, my victimization, it's important. And it is. But one of the things that will not emerge, I think, from a legacy process is solutions. I'm not sure what level of truth will emerge, but I do think it would give people an opportunity, perhaps, to express their grief, to express their suffering, to express the pain they've experienced in a more focused and a more structured way, and in a way that perhaps was a bit more respectful than many of the uneven processes through which it takes place at the moment. And even at the level of allowing people to speak, hopefully to get answers, but we must recognize many of those answers simply will not and cannot be provided. But whether it will allow more people to talk about things that are bubbling away, and bubbling away fiercely, I think that really would be the goal of it.
Thanks, Aogán. I suppose, Trevor, I'm going to ask George to say a few words on this question as well, because you did raise that point of suspending justice and truth. And, you know, I can remember an interview with Hugh Ord 13, 14 years ago, where he talked about we need to find a way of closing the book, but closing the book in some way that does something for victims. But I suppose what we shouldn't be doing is leading them up garden paths in terms of false expectations. And we've had chief constable after chief constable after chief constable telling us that the investigative process is not going to deliver what some people think it might deliver. So I don't know whether, George, you want to say a few words on that.
Well, the investigative process is not going to deliver what some people think it may deliver.
Yeah.
Just
spell that out a bit more.
I haven't said that before, but there's a very serious point here, and it's just a reality that the more time goes by, and it sounds very cold, but witnesses and families die, and memories fade, and evidence degenerates, and audit trails of evidence become less robust, and all of that can actually then turn into a conspiracy if one's not careful. The possibility of getting criminal justice outcomes as the years pass by is very difficult. And we need to be honest and realistic with that. And I think police leadership, probably over the last 15 years, has been honest about that. It hasn't done anything to unrealistically increase or raise people's expectations to a point that they can't be met. And I sort of, shortly after being appointed to this role, put a challenge out that really we needed some mechanisms, and that criminal justice mechanisms of themselves, whilst they might be the answer for some people and might be what some families and some victims, survivors want, it's not what everybody wants, and there needed to be a broader suite of opportunities for people to get some sort of closure and questions answered. I'm not saying it's because I said it or put the challenge out there, but 3 months later we did have the Stormont House Agreement that created the institutions and the infrastructure that seems to address the large, broad strands of what victims seem to be seeking. Some people just want to know the truth, what happened, when, and the degree of suffering. Some people do want a criminal justice outcome pursued. And I think the architecture that was agreed in December 14 in the Stormont House Agreement is as close as we're going to come to acknowledging that criminal justice outcomes of itself are not going to deliver people's needs in its entirety, but actually, nor should we pretend that we don't have a responsibility around pursuing valid, realistic lines of inquiry if they're presented. But there are the other things around information retrieval and storytelling and so on, and the other mechanisms that I think seem to be a pretty good framework for moving forward. My frustration, or my concern maybe is a better word than frustration, is that we're not that far away actually from December 16, and we still don't actually have any of that infrastructure in place. So a gentle, polite urge to the people in political power to get on with it and deliver some of that infrastructure would be good. I know it's Westminster legislation, and we are engaged without intervening politically, but we are engaged in our own experiences around what the bits relevant to policing might look like. So there is work going on it. But actually, victims are waiting, and 2 years has passed, and people are dying, frankly, and evidence is deteriorating, and we really need to make some progress soonest.
Maybe we should have a thought from Claire on that, Claire, about how near or how far you think we are from the realisation of what was set out in that Stormont House Agreement a couple of years ago.
Sure. I think tonight we've talked a lot about confidence in policing. I think addressing the past through the legacy mechanisms that were agreed in the Stormont House Agreement, for me, legacy is ultimately about the victims. And I think if we're to move forward in Northern Ireland on the issues that affect people on a day-to-day, they have to have confidence in us that we have address the past in some way. I'm not quite sure the legacy mechanisms that have been agreed are going to provide people with what they want from us. But I think it's a responsibility on leadership, on government, that we acknowledge it in some way. It's not a case of parking it either, in respect of the legacy inquests. Those are happening. But whether we take 25 years to do it or 5 years to do it is a decision that we need to make as soon as possible, because I agree with George in respect that people are dying, their pain and their hurt will not stop at their death. It will be passed on to the next generation, as I said earlier, and I do see it being passed on to the next generation. But I do think we're close. Alastair earlier mentioned that, you know, we want to get this right, and that is entirely right. We're in a new mandate. We have a new Secretary of State. I think in terms of the legacy, we are moving on to that more public phase, as was agreed. But we need to do it. Because you're right, 2 years has passed and people have died. And if this is about victims, well, then that's not good enough. And it's certainly something that I'm keen to support. And yes, I said that I was confident that we will find agreement, and I still am. I'm just not sure when, but I'm hopeful that it will happen soon.
What I'm going to do is I'm going to ask a few people in our audience to make, I see Sean, your hands up there, a few people to make a comment on legacy, which we'll then bring back to Chris and Alastair to have a thought on. Sean Murray's got his hand up. Winston Irvine has been making very clear recently that loyalists who have got a big part to play in a legacy process are actually sitting outside the legacy discussion and negotiation. I want to hear from Paula McFetridge, the director of the Kibosh Theatre Company. I thought, Paula, basically around how the arts have managed to tackle some of these big issues and big conversations in a way that elsewhere we haven't been able to tackle them. Colin Davidson's exhibition, Silent Testimony, visited by 80,000 people, is maybe an indication of how we can maybe think about memorial. Colin Davidson, you know, made the point that he doesn't have to paint what people should think. He paints and leaves a space for people to think for themselves. So can we get help from outside policing and politics to help us with the development of that legacy process? There's someone else here. You okay? Yeah. So we'll take Sean, we'll take Winston, we'll take Paula. Then we're going to come back to our three politicians. And then we're getting very close to the point where we're going to have to wrap this up. It's approaching 7:15. I'm going to draw the line at 7:30, if that's okay. So Sean Murray, Winston Irvine, Paula McFetridge.
Sean Murray, Sinn Féin. Partly comment, partly a question. First of all, I was delighted to hear the Chief Constable, while acknowledging the progress we have made in embedding our new policing dispensation on the bedrock, as you said, of human rights and accountability. He also acknowledged the major challenges ahead, because I think it's dangerous if we come to an event like this and we pat ourselves on the back and think all the hard work or the hard lifting's been done. Mm. While there has been, there are still major challenges ahead. Some historical, the legacy issue, which we have talked about, but also current. I heard Alastair referring to the nature of crime is changing in terms of the internet, etc. So, and acknowledging those challenges, that's a challenge for everyone in this room. That's not just a challenge for the police. And we can't park our head the past, because we can't build true reconciliation in this country unless we deal with the past. Now, it's hard we deal with the past, and it's not just a matter for the parties. That's an our fallacy. The government is also a major role to play in this. And anyone like myself who was involved in the negotiations will recognise that one of the key barriers to reaching a resolution in the Fresh Start talks was the issue around disclosure. And that wasn't just a matter for the parties, that was a matter between ourselves and between the British government as well. So in recognising those challenges, and I think there's a willingness on all sides to deal with the key challenges ahead, because that's our future. Because the past is also the present. Unless we deal with the past, that is going to cast and cloud, a massive cloud. And as someone made the reference earlier, we can't pass the parcel to the next generation. It's incumbent upon our generation to ensure that we do what we can to deal with that issue and other issues like that. But in terms of a question, Aogán had mentioned the fact that working with the communities is one of the primary challenges ahead, and I agree with that. We talk about one of the core principles of our new policing dispensation, policing with the community. And this is a question for the panel, but especially the Chief Constable. Would we all recognise that there are different expectations, there are different interpretations of what we mean by this core principle? Because I think maybe that's a barrier and has been a barrier and something we need to deal with in terms of how do we drill down in terms of what do we really mean and how do we go about building policing with the community? And I think it's a key core concept and a key issue that needs addressed.
Okay, Sean, thanks very much. And we'll take Winston Irvine next. He's just here with us.
Okay, thanks, Winston. Barney. I suppose I didn't wish to make a comment in relation to the past.
There's no such thing as a free sausage roll, Winston.
No, okay. what I was going on to say was that I would have preferred to think about what are the challenges facing both police and policing and communities as we look forward towards the next 15 years, as opposed to rehearsing what are primarily political issues that haven't been resolved. And it does frustrate me that, and this might sound contrary coming from me, but it frustrate me that we tend to focus on legacy when we're at these conferences with the police. But let me address the point that you put me on the spot for in terms of my perspective from a loyalist perspective. Look, legacy is about conflict. Legacy is about the violence that went on here as part of the civil unrest, as part of the troubles, if you want to call it that, and the victims and the survivors and the destruction and the death that was caused and was a consequence of those years of violence and destruction. And I think it's an absolute nonsense when you think that that conflict, primarily, whilst it might have had a political dimension to it, happened largely outside political parameters. The violence that took place and that communities and citizens experienced happened out in the streets. As a loyalist, and you know, historically, loyalism was undoubtedly a major protagonist in that conflict. It has then, in my view, a hugely important role to play in terms of addressing the legacy, and in particular, addressing the needs of victims and survivors. So it boggles my mind as to why loyalism and those major protagonists have been continually excluded and left outside the door, despite the fact that they've been shouting from the rooftops to play a hugely constructive role in any future legacy processes. And I don't say that by way of wanting to usurp political autonomy or anybody's democratic mandate. I say it from the point of view we need to get real. People have, you know, rehearsed the arguments about, well, where does loyalism get its mandate from? Loyalism will get its mandate from the fact that it can produce answers and information that all the unionist politicians put together couldn't come up with. So that's where it gets its mandate from. And I want to see people coming forward with ideas and solutions how you make sure that loyalists are around that table being held to account.
Okay, thanks, Winston. And Paula. Paula is director of Kibosh. She directed the play that's showing at the moment, Green and Blue, written by Lawrence McKeown, which tells the story of the guards and RUC experience of policing the border in the conflict period. So Paula, we can maybe get a thought from you.
Thank you very much. We're touring Green and Blue at the minute. It is based on stories gathered from serving Garda Síochána and RUC officers during the border over the height of the conflict. It was collected by Diversity Challenges and Queen's University, and Lawrence McKeown scripted a play from it, and we're currently touring it. Tonight we're in Strabane, sharing that story with 50 individuals. Tomorrow night we're in Dundalk. We've been touring theatres on the border. We're doing closed performances and cross-community performances. The show will continue to tour. There are people that will hear that story and hear those narratives in a year, 5 years' time, that are not ready to hear it now. And I think it's very interesting what both Richard and Aogán said. Three things that you said that I completely agree with. One is, how do we work with communities? How do we ask ourselves who isn't at the table? and how do we get them around the table? And thirdly, when is the right time to ask the question? And that is key about how we use art and how we use artists to actually help us deal with the past. Because I think we can be provocative, we take it responsibly, we know how to raise questions that then we can deal with in post-show discussions, that challenge preconceived ideas, that deal with misconceptions. We have been told since we've been touring this show for the last 2.5 weeks how people, when the two actors walk in the Garda Síochána and the RUC uniform, how they feel challenged, how they are propelled back to a hatred of the uniform and a perceived hatred of the person. And after they experience the play, they will say how their opinion of that person is completely different. They start to see the person behind the uniform. We are humanizing those people, and consequently, we are starting to have conversations that we couldn't have had 15 years ago. I do think reflecting and refocusing is very difficult. It's not passive, it's challenging. I do think we need to say, what haven't we achieved in the 15 years? Poverty levels have gone from 1 in 5 to 1 in 3. Racial attacks have quadrupled. Domestic violence has increased. We've lost more young people to suicide since the signing of the Good Friday Agreement that we did over the whole course of the conflict. There are a lot of things that we need to continue to address, and I think arts engagement is asking those questions because they're giving voice to the silent. And I would like to encourage you to continue to use us to work with you to find ways of getting those people around the table that aren't around the table. And if anybody wants to know anything more about Green and Blue, please do come and talk to me about it.
Thanks very much, Paula. I'm going to ask George to answer Sean's question directly about what is meant by policing with the community. And then I'm going to ask Chris and Alastair and Claire to give us a thought to wrap our conversation up, unless there is someone out there who has absolutely busted a gut to ask a question. Is there anyone there? Okay, so we'll take Chris, or sorry, we'll take George on the specific question, then we'll go to Chris, Alastair, and Claire, if that's okay.
That's a good question from Sean. We've had a number of glossy brochures over the last 15 years trying to answer it. One of the pitches that I made to the policing board in May 2014, when they decided to appoint me, was the George attempt at defining it. We have that right across the organisation now. We have an independent assessment from HMIC and others that tells us that our people get this, that they understand it. There's two sides to this. What we do, keeping people safe, dead simple, passes the elevator test. We protect vulnerable people, we prevent harm, and we bring offenders to justice. The important piece then on the policing with the community is more the ethos or the culture of the organisation. Tim Mayers is leading a piece of work for the last year and a half on us in this, because we need to get the mindset right internally, and that is about treating people. Some people call it nicely. I call it fairness, courtesy, respect. It's what the public expect of us. The other piece of policing with the community is that we embrace accountability. There's nobody that knows more than me how uncomfortable that is, sat in front of this policing board at times, having really prickly questions asked, and it's not comfortable. But you know what? For confidence in policing, good accountability is an absolutely key ingredient. And the third and really vital aspect is collaborative decision-making, I call it. I'm talking about partnership. I'm talking about collaboration. We use the language collaborative decision-making because we want to get to the point of action and deciding and actually doing something instead of having cozy meetings where the police always pay for the tea and biscuits. So that's policing with the community. It's a partnership piece. It's the accountability piece, and it's treating people properly with common decency the way we'd expect our loved ones to be treated. And that message and that clarity is getting right across the organisation. Our independent surveys, our inspections from HMIC are showing us that. We still have a way to go with it. But the other part of your commentary, Sean, was also quite insightful around policing is changing, because it's really important that we start to educate people about what policing with the community isn't. It has been billed and perceived and believed to be in a number of quarters about high visibility policing. And of course, that is an aspect of it. But this is not just about officers in high visibility jackets out in communities. It's about a mindset and about a way that we think. So as we see a 40% increase last year in child sexual exploitation being reported to us, as we see an increase in less public crimes like domestic abuse being reported to us, That is taking people out of a less visible place into a more hidden place to deal with that. We see cybercrime going through the roof, or at least our understanding, our appreciation of it, is going through the roof. All of this tends to take policing away from a public place into a less visible place. And that's a concern for us, because if we define policing with the community about just pure visible policing, then we're going to let down the policing board, we're going to let down the public. The public, the board, the people who are engaged and stakeholders in policing need to have an understanding of how that demand is changing. How we deal with that demand should be in a way that's still entirely accountable, should be in partnership and collaboration with other people, and we should be engaging with people in a way that's respectful and fair, because, and with that I'm talking about the whole equality piece and the non-discriminatory practice. That's what our understanding of policing with the community is, but it's as much about understanding what it isn't. It's also, you know, a gauge of policing with the community in the past has been when we did have some surpluses, what money the police were putting into initiatives at a community level that we can no longer afford to do. And that is seen, and it's been reported in some quarters as the police pulling back from policing with the community because we're not funding certain community projects that, frankly, were good projects, but I might have sat with, dare I say it, the Department of Communities or the Department of Infrastructure or somewhere else within the executive to actually fund it. We have done that and acted in good faith. Then as the resource dries up and you stop doing it, it feels like you're pulling back from what some people's perception of policing with the community is.
Okay. Sean, I know we don't have time to debate this tonight, but there was an issue raised, and it's about that community relationship with policing, particular to the nationalist and Republican communities' relationship with policing. Peter Sheridan raised the other night that he felt Sinn Féin had held policing on probation for too long. It raised a concern that young people joining the police today from those communities that they wouldn't have joined from previously still can't live in those communities. And I suppose also there is a challenge for the Catholic Nationalist Republican community about addressing some of that unfinished business as well. But that'll be an issue for another night. I'm told we've got 4 minutes left. That means Chris, Alastair, Claire and Anne have a minute each. For one last big thought, and then we're going to get a cup of tea and a cup of coffee. Okay, Chris, thank you.
Thank you, as usual. I'll try and squeeze two thoughts in, and you know, two for the price of one. But I suppose to draw some parallels with the health debate, you know, in recent days and over the last week, you know, there's been a big focus on health and the reforms of health. And I do see parallels in that, you know, to a certain extent, we don't have a health system. We have a sick system, and the system kicks in whenever you're unwell. And we don't take enough initiative around preventative measures and the likes of that. And for me, this is exactly the case. And this is the real need to address now this issue of policing with the community. And some of the stuff that has been touched on earlier, I think is vitally important. We see the strength of community restorative justice. And even again, another, I suppose, an issue that's been in the media lately is, you know, the social investment fund. Some of the successes of some of these things have been absolutely brilliant. And I have no doubt these are the successes the PSNI want to see at an earlier stage, building in capacity in some community organisations to be able to deal and head off. But there's no doubt, and the lady at the back picked up on it, around, you know, poverty, dealing with the effects of social deprivation. And that won't just have great benefits for the likes of our education system, but of course, when it comes to policing. Just finally, you know, I was down with the Loch and Island families recently, and this is, I suppose, touch on legacy. And we've talked about the need now to, you know, go forward, and we're at a crossroads. But certainly, and it still sits with me, that one of the family members that night said, you know, and we were talking about the actual report and the Ombudsman's report into the Loch and Island massacre, and says, you know, what would this report have looked like if national security veto was available? You know, what would that report have looked like? And I can see the transformative effect that that report has had on the families. You know, in that sense of closure now, there nearly is upon that community. And we nearly are, at the situation with Loch and Island where, you know, there are issues of accountability, of course, but there did come closure with that. Would that not have been the case? And certainly that's perhaps a thought that I would leave with tonight.
Okay, thanks, Chris. And you didn't just take a minute there, Chris. So we're going to have Alastair and Claire and Anne to speak us out of this event then.
Okay, just to sort of wrap up or maybe summarise some of the comments that have been made from the floor, I mean, the first thing I would say is that it's been alluded to earlier around the age profile of the three of us that are here. I mean, my motivation to get into politics wasn't based on the past. It was very much about the future. It was a motivation of getting a better future, more opportunities for younger people, making Northern Ireland the most successful region that we can make it. And in that sense, I share Winston's frustration that sometimes at these events, we do focus more on the past than the current challenges or where we want to get to in the future. And I actually suspect that at a political level, there's probably more agreement on where we want to get to in the future and how we address some of the issues that we have at the moment. And I suspect that there wouldn't be an iota of difference between the three of us in terms of the kind of police service that we want to see that's keeping the community safe, that has confidence across the community, that's helping vulnerable people out there, and of course that's well-resourced. So I can understand why Trevor makes the point is perhaps if we press the pause button, does it take away some of these problems, does it allow us to focus on the future? And I can see why there's a certain attraction to that. I think the danger in it is that if the legacy in the past remains an open sore, it becomes more difficult to solve when some of the actors pass away or are no longer here, then they can't take responsibility for what they have done in the past, or they can't be held account for what they have done in the past. And sometimes when the next generation picks up the mantle or picks up some of those grievances, they become even more entrenched, more difficult to resolve. And if we look at experiences across the world, that's probably what we would come to that conclusion. In terms of making sure that loyalists are part of the process and whatever happens, like everybody needs to be part of that process. If it's the work, everybody has to be part of it. And in the coming weeks when the government and the Secretary of State moves into what he's called the more public phase of things, everybody's voice needs to be listened to. Everybody needs to contribute to that. We need to make sure that the victims sector, and they all have different asks, they have different needs, they have different wants. They all need to be part of that process. They need to make sure that they feed into it. We need to listen to both serving and retired police officers and what their expectation is out of all of this, because we need to get the maximum buy-in and maximum confidence whenever architecture or agreement is made in that, otherwise it just simply won't work at all. And of course we need to manage expectation as well. In terms of the role of the arts, and it was interesting when you mentioned about getting behind the uniform, one of the most powerful campaigns that I have seen over the last year was when the Policing Federation had their campaign around who a police officer is, that they're mothers and fathers and brothers and sisters, and they have normal lives as well, and they have to go home to those lives, and they have to bring some of the traumatic experiences of the experience during their day job home to their family lives. And I think that was a really, really powerful campaign, and I think it helped the wider community to truly value the work that police officers do and the risk that they put themselves at to keep the rest of us safe. And I think we should never underestimate the important contribution and the sacrifice that the police officers make. And very finally, if I can just wrap up on this point, in terms of what we want the police service to look like, and we've mentioned this collaboration, and it's the buzzword at the moment, the Programme for Government, around collaboration and all that partnership stuff as well. But it's important because resources are diminishing. We don't have as much money as we used to have. You know, Claire will tell you that 70% of our budget's going towards policing. It's not sustainable when there's other pressures there in health service, education and infrastructure and everything else as well. But if we have true partnership government, if we have a joined up approach where we are trying to tackle some of the education issues, some of the health issues, some of the alcohol abuse, some of the mental health issues that actually do take up police time and suck up police resources, then we can help the police in terms of the role that they have. And that's why that collaboration is so important, and why partnership between the executive and wider government and with the police and with the community voluntary sector and with wider community is so important. And I think that we're in a better space now in Northern Ireland to have that genuine partnership than we ever have had in the past. And I hope that in 15 years' time, we are looking at the police service of Northern Ireland as an exemplar across the world in terms of proper community policing and having a real positive impact in the community as well.
Thank you, Alastair. Claire, he's left you 4 seconds.
I suppose I'll finish where I started. I'm an elected representative. It's not appropriate in my mind to bring my baggage to the table because it's not about me. It's about the people of Northern Ireland. And I won't assume that I know what's best for them. I'll go out and ask, which is why I believe that communities play such a big role in how we move forward. To come back to the focus about police, when we look at the role that the Police Service of Northern Ireland will have moving forward, we need to look at the people of Northern Ireland and understand what their issues are. And from that, we can develop how we can best strategise in terms of what the police needs to do, but on a wider scale, what public service needs to do. Every one of us sitting on this stage tonight is here as a public servant, and I think we need to bring that focus back. We need to go back to our communities, and we need to go back to our people, and I think everything else will follow from that.
Thank you, Claire. And Anne.
Okay, well, first of all, on the legacy, I would just say get it sorted, because even if the police had the money and the resources in the morning, they wouldn't be acceptable to most of the victims. Police are already using much-needed resources to fund two inquiries currently. So I think, you know, we need to look at that. There's a big job to be done in the what I would term day-to-day policing. In terms of policing with the community, we had had a chat about that earlier. We need to get the debate going again, because people see policing with the community as synonymous with neighbourhood policing, and indeed with having a police station on your corner. So we need to get back to the ethos and the discussion around that, and I think make the public aware that that's what policing with the community is, because they're definitely not. We still get complaints about police stations closing, even though they've been closed for years, you know, which is quite amusing that nobody's been using them, but there are complaints as soon as they go up for sale. And finally, I think, just back to what people said about the partnership, what Aogán was talking about, early intervention, 35, 40 years ago, when I was a young teacher, and I know now I'm the oldest on the panel, that was a big issue around how, you know, particularly children in care, and I know this will be a discussion tomorrow, but how do you get true partnership to deal with that so that the police literally aren't left holding the baby at 10 o'clock on a Friday night, which they usually are. So we need to deal with that, but we need to get the commitment from the very top, from the executive, and I think we've now got a programme for government and an outcomes-based approach, which will help us to do that, and hopefully we'll start to see you know, a change in how partnerships work.
Okay, Anne, thanks very much. I want to thank Chris, Alastair, Claire, Anne, George, Richard, and Aogán. I've got a message in front of me saying that there's music, chat, and don't forget to tell people about the exhibition. I think one of the big achievements of the last 2.5 hours, George, is that we got through it without a Twitter controversy. Let he or she who has not sinned on Twitter cast the first 140 characters. Good night, and may your God go with you. Thank you very much.